Okay, welcome everyone. I'm excited to introduce this conference with some personal ideas on mysticism, which I hope will be radically challenged in these 2 days. And after this brief introduction, I will proceed to my recent work on Hegel and Nishida. So what is contemporary mysticism? And this is a very different question, I think. Today and tomorrow, we will have a look at some more simple questions, which are mutually entangled, so that we could throw the central question back into the discussion, which is the central aspect of this conference. What is mysticism and what is its relation to philosophy? What is contemporary counterculture, given that we are talking about the present moment, not about a movement in the past, which has actually become a big cliche? And of course, as we discussed also in the pre-meeting last week, these are all words or concepts, and a lot of you will disagree with the philosopher's fetish for categories, or at least will have a healthy distrust toward language. The problem is, of course, that without words, it would be difficult to share our mystical experience of the nameless, of the one, or whatever else you will call it. So are philosophy and mysticism and counterculture in the final instance one? Yes, they are, but they are at the same time different, each reflecting or refracting a different notion or a different tone of our topic. Or in a deeper sense, they are different expressions or manifestations of the nameless itself. And indeed, they're also constantly reshaping each other, shifting their meanings and feeding back onto themselves in a circular way. In a way, they're like the Trinity in the medieval idea of perichoresis, dancing around the nameless void, like in this icon of Andrei Rublev. Okay, this might be a joke, but I'm not sure if it is a joke indeed. The empty chora in the center is etymologically linked to both a place and a dance. I just give you a moment to contemplate. So let us come back to a more simple question. What is mysticism? Not what is contemporary mysticism, but what is mysticism? To stick to etymology, it is derived from the Greek mystikos, something secret or hidden or unknown, something you cannot grasp with your mind. But this term may be traced further to mystis, which is actually the initiated person involved in the Eleusinian mysteries, which was actually we can call it an underground festival in ancient Greece. Chiara Baldini goes as far as to compare it to the Boom Festival nowadays in Portugal, and she argues that the mystery was all about losing one's ego in a collective rave of narcotic drugs and dance. Chiara argues further that these mysteries in ancient Greece and Rome had to be kept secret because they were considered a true danger to the state. And of course, a bunch of open-minded, queer, and structurally neglected people coming together must be a danger to the law and order of all oppressive states. And which state is not oppressive after all? So all mystics, at least in the past, were hidden in the underground, not because they were playing cool, but because mysticism is a very dangerous business. And those who spoke up were burned at the stake. Just to get you a feel for what we will be talking about here, some examples will help to further circulate around the question, what is mysticism? While the term is, of course, Greek, and there were several underground movements in Europe, such as Neoplatonism, Hermeticism, alchemy, and so on and so on. We rather tend to associate the term with Asia, of course, with all kinds of cliches and Orientalisms involved. Our idea is to have a closer look at such traditions as Advaita Vedanta, Taoism, Mahayana, and Zen Buddhism, and to free them from the colonizing gaze, both in terms of European reductionism and too naive exoticism, which is another form of reductionism after all. Now let me try to get some common themes together. In terms of philosophical mysticism, it is clear that all forms of mysticism affirm a nameless absolute which goes beyond the realm of language. This can be the eternal Tao or Brahma or the One and so on and so on. It can also be nothing or Mu in Japanese. The main point is that we cannot talk about it, so let us try to be silent about it. Mystical experience marks the direct encounter with the nameless, and this seems to be the core of common mysticism. And of course, this sublime encounter in each particular case is very difficult to be described to others, and mystics tend to make use of images and metaphorical language, and also music is a proper mode of expression, as we will see. There's something paradoxical in these experiences, and mystical philosophers in the West have described it in the Latin terms of the coincidentia oppositorum. The coincidence or unity of opposites, which was attributed to the absolute. So, can we speak about the absolute or not? It felt like a great blessing to me when I came across the different notions of expression or of avatars or manifestations of the absolute in the literature of mysticism, because these, call it expressions, call it appearances or just illusions, these, even if you call them illusions, they cannot be entirely disconnected from the absolute. However small they are the manifestations of the absolute itself, and it expresses itself exactly through these manifestations. In a way, the absolute is nothing but its manifestations, but the meaning of this term "it is" becomes very complicated. So, after this brief introduction to the conference, I'll move on to my recent work on Hegel and Nishida, which is closely related to all these topics. Philosophy in general is considered as opposed to mysticism. So let's make this point clear from the beginning. It is like a taboo or an ethical code. It is considered bad manners for a philosopher to be engaged with mysticism, even to mention a mystic in one's bibliography. And at the same time, the greatest thinkers actually were thoroughly inspired by mysticism. Yet another paradox, but why not? I came across the work of Glenn Maggie and Philip Stanfield. In Maggie, he had a closer look at Hegel's early contact with mystical ideas, which remained a driving force for his philosophy throughout his lifetime. Maggie argues that Hegel kept his youthful mystical ambitions hidden in his early career as a philosopher, and increasingly referred to mystics when he was already very much established. Although Hegel is usually considered as a very obsessive rationalist, following Maggie, mysticism is the driving force of his entire oeuvre. And Philip Stanfield goes as far as to consider Hegel as the consummate Neoplatonist, an idea which obviously did not get very far in academia, at least not yet. Just to give you a taste of Maggie's findings, here's a refreshing quote from Hegel's later work, The Encyclopedia of the Philosophical Sciences. I quote Hegel, it should also be mentioned here that the meaning of the speculative is to be understood as being the same as what used in earlier times to be called mystical, especially with regard to the religious consciousness and its content. Thus, everything rational can equally be called mystical, but, and there always is a but, of course, this only amounts to saying that it transcends the understanding. But what is the understanding? And I'm afraid we'll need some Hegelian terminology to grasp this point. But I think this is really it, that both philosophy and mysticism go beyond the reductive limitations of the understanding in a more holistic way. It's really hot here. I now come to my central essay, The Logic of Sokohi in Hegel and Nishida, which I presented some weeks ago at the online conference Dynamic Encounters Between East and West in Cambridge. My main point here is to overcome the general dichotomy between mystical experience and logic. And of course, it is on the side of logic where I see a lack and therefore a potential to come closer to the notion of a, call it a mystical philosophy. In this talk, I actually equated modern logic with fascism, a move which was understandably not very welcome to all. But my main point is here that mysticism does no longer have to be opposed to philosophy and logic as soon as our sense of logic opens up itself to mystical experience. And the work of Hegel and Nishida is a great inspiration for me in this sense, or for all of us. So to come to Hegel and Nishida, the similarities are close at hand. Both consider their own logic as a form of dialectics, which dynamically develops in terms of self-consciousness or of self-reference and embraces contradiction at its very core. This sense of dialectics, moreover, acknowledges Spinoza's dictum omnis determinatio est negatio, which means all determination is negation, which eventually will lead to the contradictory identity of affirmation and negation. And you will recognize the mystical idea of the coincidentia oppositorum in these. But let us firstly get an overview about the following. I will start with the original formulation of the Sokohi logic as it was provided by the famous mystic Suzuki, who had a vivid correspondence with Nishida on the topic. When it comes to Hegel, I will spare you from the greater science of logic and will limit the discussion to the smaller encyclopedia logic. In Nishida, we will see the great influence of Hegel, but also his commitment to Buddhist logic in his later years. So here we come to the Sokohi logic. The original formulation was given by Suzuki in this formula. To say A is A is to say A is not A. Therefore, A is A. Fortunately, he elaborates on that. It means that affirmation is negation as well as negation is affirmation. Thus, in the Prajnaparamita thought, which is a set of Buddhist sutras, statements are made such as a mountain is not a mountain, a river is not a river, and therefore a mountain is a mountain, a river is a river. And he goes on, the Buddha preached that the perfection of wisdom is at the same time not the perfection of wisdom, and therefore it is called the perfection of wisdom. Referring to this formulation, I call it the logic of Sokohi, I'm not sure if it should be called logic, but let us leave at that for now. And this is the tricky point. So I think concerning Suzuki Stout, if it should be called logic, we have to clarify that he was certainly not interested in the formulation of a strictly philosophical logic of thought, but in the mystical experience expressed in the Prajnaparamita Sutras. However, as I said, my intent is not to deepen the dichotomy of experience and thought, but to develop a new way of thinking which is consistent with experience. And although Nishida was thoroughly inspired by Suzuki's formulations, he wrote a letter to his friend addressing his concerns in terms of Western logic. This is a letter from Nishida to Suzuki. What you call the Prajnaparamita logic of Soko here is full of suggestion. We must construct it logically so that it can stand on its own to face Western logic. If we don't do that, it might be labeled unscientific and we may end up depriving the Eastern thought of its strength from developing into a globally viable system of thought. You see, mysticism in philosophy, at least in the West, is overall conceived as something very bad in a way. But interestingly, such a logical foundation that Nishida asked for, a logical foundation of mysticism in a way, was arguably provided by Hegel more than a century before Nishida. However, we will also see why Nishida was reserved in applying Hegel's thought to Suzuki's logic of Sokuhi. Now, Hegel's Encyclopedia of the Philosophical Sciences in Outline, that's the whole title, was originally composed as a preliminary guide for his lectures on philosophy. Nevertheless, it includes insights into his thought, which are more profound than any lecture. Hegel starts his so-called Encyclopedia logic, which is the first part of the encyclopedia, with the precise articulation of the three, he calls them moments or aspects involved in his logic. So I'll be quoting some Hegel now. He writes, with regard to its form, the logical has three sides, the side of abstraction or of the understanding, the dialectical or negatively rational side, and the speculative or positively rational. And then he continues developing these three aspects. So firstly, thinking as understanding stops short at the fixed determinacy and its distinctness vis-a-vis other determinacies. Such a restricted abstraction counts for the understanding as one that subsists on its own account and simply is. Hegel comments that thinking is often conceived as the mere activity of the understanding, a misconception. Oh, now the wind is coming in, huh? Taxi. A misconception, which leads to the dichotomy of a merely abstract thinking on the one hand and a concrete feeling or intuition on the other hand. And as is apparent also in Suzuki, thinking this way is conceived as, Hegel writes, hard and one-sided, and thus is unable to compete with concrete experience. And Hegel responds to that such criticisms against thought in general, in fact, only hold for the thinking of the understanding, which, as we have seen, stops short at the fixed determinacy and its distinctness vis-a-vis other determinacies. Rational thinking, on the other hand, negates such abstract determinations and is therefore concrete, and this will also be the case in Nishida. Now, the dialectical, so the second, the dialectical or negatively rational moment is the self-sublation of these finite determinations on their own part and they're passing into the opposites. So for Hegel, every determination already contains its opposite, what obviously will lead to contradiction. But in his dialectics, contradiction is not a mere mistake of our subjective reasoning, but it is the contradiction is the driving force of reason itself and even of every living being, that something is alive is only because it is contradictory in itself. So let's take a pause here to recapitulate this basic move of Hegel. The mystic says basically that thought is unable to grasp the paradox of mystical experience. And Hegel says, all right, but your idea of thought is limited to what I call the understanding. What Hegel calls reason, on the other hand, is paradoxical in itself and is therefore close to mysticism. And now let us recall Suzuki's formulation of the Sokuhi logic. So thus far, the first two lines seem to be in accordance with Hegel's exposition of his logic. To say a mountain is a mountain goes in line with the abstract determinations of the understanding. And to say a mountain is not a mountain corresponds with the dialectical or the negatively rational aspect of logic. But concerning the third line, Hegel's intent, I think, is not merely to return to A, as in Suzuki. And this seems to be the central difference between Hegel and Suzuki, and especially also Hegel and Nishida. So Hegel does not intend to return to A, but to transcend it in terms of a new concept B, which is, he says, higher and richer than the preceding. He thus closes the introduction to the encyclopedia logic with the positive aspect of his famous concept of sublation. This is now the third aspect of his logic. The speculative or positively rational apprehends the unity of the determinations in their opposition, the affirmative that is contained in their dissolution and in their transition. Gilles Deleuze, I worked on, has noted that Hegel here still makes use of the Aristotelian principle of non-contradiction, not contradiction, but non-contradiction, in order to proceed from contradiction to what he calls determinate negation, the famous concept of Hegel. This determinate negation of the concept A forms the very content of the following concept B, which is once again self-identical. And we may summarize Hegel's logic of Sokuhi, so to say. To say A is A is to say A is not A, therefore A is B. In Hegel, A is B precisely because it is self-contradictory and thus dissolves into a higher concept. Now let me come to Nishida. Nishida was very much engaged with Hegel's work throughout his entire lifetime. And his later works, when he was very much established, he acknowledged his great influences from mysticism. Sounds familiar, no? Nishida frequently refers to Neoplatonism and especially to Nicholas of Cusa in the West, and also a lot to Mahayana and Zen Buddhism in the East. And one could say that his later commitment to a new form of logic was motivated by the idea to give a logical foundation to mysticism, as we have also seen in his letter to Suzuki. Now, against Hegel's concept of sublation, Nishida thoroughly agrees with Suzuki's formulation and thus returns to everyday experience. A is A. But I also ask myself, is not the A in line 3 is slightly different A from the A in line 1. To clarify this question, let us have a closer look at Nishida's logic, which he calls, also has a nice name, the logic of absolute contradictory self-identity. In Nishida's Dialectics of Time, time at first proceeds in a linear fashion from the past through the present to the future, but in a similar way to Hegel's dialectics, past and future in Nishida are contraries, which, however, mutually determine one another. So we have contraries which include one another. And accordingly, the present is the contradictory self-identity of past and future, or what Nishida calls the place of time, also Basho. So the present as a contradictory self-identity ceaselessly negates itself, constituting the flux of time as a continuity of discontinuity from present to present. And even though Nishida here was certainly inspired by Hegel, his Dialectics of Time does certainly not dissolve into a higher concept. The present here instead becomes ever more concrete in the lived experience of the eternal now. So here we see the self-reference of the present, the eternal now, which instead of utterly transcending time, accomplishes eternity within the fleeting moment. This contradiction of the present in Nishida is thus not merely sublated in terms of the Aristotelian principle of non-contradiction, but it becomes ever more deepened, one can say, deepened or intensified. So just to give another example, Nishida's Dialectics of the human individual and its environment has the great advantage that only two terms are involved, what further emphasizes the contrast to classical Hegelianism. The environment determines the individual, but in the case of human individuals in the Anthropocene, also the individual drastically determines the environment. Now, since the individual is determined by its environment, and since it determines the environment in return, what Nishida calls inverse determination, the individual eventually determines itself. So we have the same image like with the present. And moreover, since all determination is negation, the individual eventually negates itself, or it is once again absolute contradictory self-identity. It is this centrality of self-reference in Nishida's dialectics which opens links to complex systems theory and of course also to mysticism, and may serve as a direction for a more holistic way of thinking. Note, for example, that so-called modern logic has the greatest difficulties to cope with self-reference, for example, in the famous liar paradox. In Nishida's words, when we are aware of ourselves, our self already transcends itself. And another quote, the reality of self-consciousness, that the self knows itself, is already self-contradictory. As we have seen in Hegel, self-identity is always the result of contradiction. But in Hegel, it always follows the contradiction. So it is due to the principle of non-contradiction, which is logically equivalent to the law of identity. And in Nishida, the self is self-identically not following contradiction, but precisely because it is absolutely contradictory. So precisely because the self negates itself by negating its environment, is it truly individual or self-identical? And we may thus summarize that Hegel's logic still acknowledges the Aristotelian principle of non-contradiction and thus proceeds from concept A to B, from B to C, and so on. Nishida's logic, on the other hand, embraces contradiction as the very core of self-identity, without the aim for definite solutions of the paradox, rather, as we said, an intensification or a deepening. So I may conclude, and you will get tired, I may conclude with two different readings of the practice of the koan, just to concretely compare Hegel to Nishida. This here is a classical koan cited by Nishida. If you call this a bamboo stick, you already miss its reality. If you do not call it that, then you are wrong. What do you call it? So Hegel would probably answer that the single bamboo dies and dissolves in its genus, or that the bamboo stick construed as an object with its properties is contradictory in itself and thus dissolves into a higher concept. Hegel's encyclopedia logic and actually his entire oeuvre may be construed as a vast set of koans to which he provides adequate solutions in terms of Western metaphysics. But Nishida's logic of absolute contradictory self-identity makes us aware that the whole point of a koan is not at all its solution, but the paradoxical nature of existence, which remains unresolved in all eternity. This will be enough, I think. Thank you very much for listening. And this was a complicated talk, especially for those who are not familiar with the work of Nishida and Hegel. So I'm open to all questions, also concerning my short introduction. And please, let's try to make this a discussion, not just a Q&A. Thank you.